figured out what he wanted to do with his life. He was a senior in high school, and so his father came up with a little test for him. His parents wrote him a note and put it on the hall table, and around the note they arrayed a $10 bill, a bottle of whiskey, and a Bible. And the note said, "Take what you're interested in. Mom and I have gone out for the evening." And then they hid in the closet. And they waited for their son to come home, and they peeked out through the crack in the door. And the father had whispered to the mother ahead of time and said, "Now, if he takes the $10 bill, he'll be a businessman. And if he takes the Bible, he'll be a pastor. But if he takes the whiskey, he will be a wastrel." And so they peered through the crack in the door, and the son came home, and he picked up the note, and he read it. And then he picked up the $10 bill and he held it up to the light and put it in his pocket. And then he took the Bible and flipped through the pages and stuck it up under his arm. And then he took the top off the whiskey and took a slug, and then he went up to his room. And the father said, "Oh, it's worse than I thought." "What, dear? What is it?" "He's going to be a politician." Sorry. It is the season. We're talking this morning about a dysfunctional family. And now, the way this parable has traditionally been understood, particularly in the West, what's the name of this parable?
The prodigal son.
Yes, and that's not what it is. It doesn't say that in the Bible. Nobody in the Eastern Church calls it that, and nobody in the ancient church called it that. But in the Western Church, and in the modern Western Church, we call it the story of the prodigal son. Because the hero of the story is this son who takes his father's resources and goes to the big city and blows them on wild living and comes to his senses, and he repents and he comes home, and all is well and everybody lives happily ever after. But that's not what the parable is about. Now, what I'm about to tell you is going to ruin the parable for you, because it ruined the parable for me. And this comes from a man named Kenneth Bailey. He lived for 47 years in the Middle East as a New Testament professor and a missionary, and he would travel around and live in these small villages in the Middle East in order to understand the culture of the Middle East, to better understand what's taking place in the pages of Scripture. And so he wrote a book called Poet and Peasant, A Literary Cultural Approach to the Parables in Luke's Gospel. So this is where I got it from, Kenneth Bailey. So he says, no, this story is not about the prodigal, it's about a dysfunctional family. It's about a father who is foolish, and it's about two hard-hearted sons and their public scandal of the way they went about their business. Now, in the ancient world, you didn't get your inheritance until dad died. But the younger son came to the father and demanded his share of the inheritance. In other words, he's saying to his father, "You're dead to me. I have no use for you. I don't care about you. I don't care about the family. I don't care about our standing within the village in which we live. I just want mine, and I want to go live my life." And so cultural anthropologists and cross-cultural psychologists talk about the difference of cultures. Now, in the West, we live in an individualistic culture, and so it's all about us and our achievements, and we give praise to, and diplomas and certificates hang on our walls when we're successful, and that is lauded in our society. But in a honor-based, relational society, it's what's good for the community that's important, not what's good for the individual. And Jesus and his listeners didn't live in an individualistic culture. They lived in a communal, relational, honor, shame-based culture. And so Jesus tells them this story, and his listeners can't make hide nor hair out of this story. Doesn't make any sense. What son asks his father for his inheritance, and then, public scandal, his father gives it to him? He divides the inheritance. He gives his younger son what he asked for. He divided the inheritance, so he also gave his older son the inheritance. And so the village people are thinking, what's wrong with these people? And so their response would be, this is a messed up family. You know the Addams Family on television in the 60s? kind of, it was humorous because they kind of went against the grain of society, and that's what's going on here. And so the natural response of the village would be to close ranks. These people are messed up, and we don't want to have anything to do with them because we don't want their dysfunction to enter into our family and into our village. And so the father's concern here is to restore his standing in the village. If they lose face, his sons won't be able to marry any of the daughters in the village. His daughters won't be asked for marriage by any of the sons in the village. They will lose their social and economic network. So his concern is, how do I keep the family together? This is about the long-term survival of his family, not the story about the prodigal son. So we have this father who now shames himself in the eyes of the villagers. He's done something absolutely stupid. What he should have done is beat the son publicly for such an outrage, and that would have restored face, but he didn't do that. He split the inheritance. So now he is a byword to the people in the village. And so then it gets worse. So the son comes home. The son goes away and he squanders his resources. He is the quintessential peasant who goes to the big city and blows all that he has, hoping to better himself, and ends up with nothing. And it's not about repentance. He comes home because he's hungry. Any of the servants in my father's house have plenty of bread to eat, and here I'm longing to eat the pods that are being fed to the pigs. So he comes to his senses, he knows where food is, and so he comes slinking home with his tail between his legs. And again, his father's appropriate, proper response would have been first to disown him, but he hasn't done that. So then it would be to beat him. And he doesn't do that either. So he compounds the scandal, one scandal on top of another scandal. And it's even worse. He runs out to meet him. And in the ancient Near East, old men don't run because it's shameful. They have to hike up their skirts and it shows their ankles to everybody. And it's a sign of being out of control. And they are mocked and made fun of. And so what does the father do? He hikes up his skirts and he goes running after his son. Now, the word there is dramon, and it's the word for full exertion. And he does this not because it's his son who has come home. Old men don't run, period. They certainly don't run to greet people, and they definitely don't run to greet their children. Their children serve them. They don't serve their children. So this is all upside down. So he's compounding his embarrassment, his humiliation, his foolishness in the eyes of the entire village by hiking up his skirts and running to greet his son. And the greeting of his son, his hug and his embrace and the robe and the ring, all of these things aren't done to greet the son. They're done to show the village that they can't beat the son. See, the elders of the village, if they'd found out the son was coming home and got there before the father, they would have done what the father should have done, and they would have beaten the son. So the father runs out to greet the son because the son's in danger, and so he's showing the village that he's under the protection of his father. Once again, compounding his foolishness, compounding the scandal in the eyes of the village. So now he's got to reconcile his son and the village. So he does this by throwing a party. He didn't slaughter a goat. He didn't slaughter a sheep. He slaughtered the fattened calf. It's big. It's big enough to feed the entire village. And in verse 25, it says, there was dancing and there was music. He's bribing the village and trying to buy off their scruples by inviting them to a big party. And it worked. They all came. They came, they had a party, they were dancing, they were eating, and he's done what he needed to do. He's brought reconciliation to his son and to the village, only he's only halfway there. Now there's the older son. Now the older son shames his father because he refuses to come in. So he insults his father and he insults his guests. The job of the older son in a village like this when there is a party is to greet all of the guests, stand by the door, greet them all, to make sure that we don't run out of wine, to make sure that we don't run out of food, and he's not even going to come in. So the father again compounds the embarrassment, the humiliation, by begging his older son to come in rather than commanding it, or beating him. Again, he doesn't do the expected thing. Now, the people listening to this parable are, what on earth is wrong with this man? And what kind of family is this that just perpetuates scandal after scandal after scandal? And why would Jesus tell a parable like this? It just doesn't seem to make any sense. So now we look at the characters in the parable. And remember the context. Go back to verses 1 through 3, and it says, "Now tax collectors and sinners were drawing near to him. These are people who are outcast because of sin. And the Pharisees and the scribes grumbled." Now these are people who are the cream of the crop, and everybody looks up to them. And, well, that's what we have in the parable. The younger son is a tax collector and the sinner, the outcast. He is hard-hearted because of selfishness. He wants what he wants when he wants it. He wants it now. He's a young man, and the job of adolescence is individuation, separation, autonomy. Figure out what I believe, not what my parents believe. Decide for myself what I think is right, and I want control of my life. And young people want this. They want control. And often, they take more control than they're capable of taking, and that's what happens in the story here. He falls flat on his face. Now there's the older brother, and the older brother standing in for the Pharisees. And he's hard-hearted, not because of selfishness. He's hard-hearted because of self-righteousness. "You're so bad, and I'm so good, and I don't want you back. Dad threw a party, and in order to pay for the party, he's spending my money. Not your money, my money." Now, when they divide the inheritance, the older son gets 2 shares, the younger son gets 1. So a third of the estate has been squandered, and there's 2/3 of it left, and the father divided it, so it now belongs to the older son. So whose fattened calf was it? The older son's. Whose money's being spent on wine and parties and songs and bands? The older son's. So he's angry. You've brought him back home. Now, notice a few things here. He's self-righteous. He doesn't even want his brother back. And he's resentful of his brother because his brother's spending his money. He's angry at his brother, and he shames his father once again. He says, not my brother has come home. He says, your son. So he's disowned. He's done the expected thing. He's disowned his brother. Your son, not my brother. And then he's got a wicked mind. There were no stories about harlots until the older brother says he squandered your money on harlots. See, that's how he would have squandered the money. That's what he wanted to do. And it says, "All these years I've never disobeyed you." That was grim servitude. It wasn't joyful service to his father. It wasn't this family thing. It was all about him all the time. And that's the Pharisees and the scribes. So what we have here are two hard-hearted brothers and a father in this dysfunctional family. And it is about the father. The father is a stand-in for God. What is it that the father is trying to do here? And it says a lot about God. First, that the father cares more about people than he does about property. He cares more about relationships than he does about stuff or about wealth. He cares more for his sons than he does the approval of the village. It also talks about how he cares about reconciliation, even at the cost of his own dignity. You know, God condescended by becoming Jesus Christ, by becoming a human being, that he left the glories of heaven and came down. He gave up his prerogatives as God to come down and to be reconciled. He didn't stand on his dignity and require that we clean up our act. He's got tax collectors and the sinners. That's who Jesus is talking to. That's the younger brother. He's got the scribes and the Pharisees who are righteous by far beyond everybody else. And that's the older brother. And they're not reconciled to one another. And they're not reconciled to God. And so Jesus tells this story. Now, it doesn't end with a happy ending. He's gone from scandal to scandal, and it's still a scandal. Now, the older brother hasn't come in, and it doesn't tell us how it ends. Does the brother come in? It doesn't say that. And so the father is still hung out to dry in the eyes of the village. And God, our Father, is still hung out to dry in the eyes of the world. So Jesus tells this parable in order to tell us a couple of things. That when we're closer to the kingdom of God, when we step away from our dignity and step away from our rights and step away from our self-righteousness, we're closer to the kingdom of God, because that's what the Father in the parable does, and that's what God the Father does for us. Two hard-hearted responses to God: selfishness and living our lives the way we want to. That's the way the world lives, and yet the Father wants to be reconciled to that. And then there's the religious people, self-righteous people. We're the good people. We're the older brother, and yet we're as hard-hearted as the younger son is. And God wants to reconcile both groups to himself. That's the message of the parable this morning. Amen.